now, because all they have to do is differentiate themselves by just elevating themselves like one notch, not like 10,
right,
one notch above what everybody else is doing. So.
I mean, you're always impeccably dressed. I don't care if we're on the chamber train ride to Washington D.C. with the politicians,
great.
Or we're
I
in
know.
A hotel lobby doing a charity event as we did together. You're always dressed, and I think it sends an image.
Me. I didn't realize we were actually muted. So I just want to give a quick rerun of what we were doing. And I'm sorry, I just look. My producers actually started their own show.
Okay.
And they actually have been building. So I gave them free will to go and build their business. But if you didn't hear what we were saying, I know, and I'm sorry. This is the joy about
going live.
We're back. But the GoFundMe campaign for the Shark Tank, we're writing a book, we're franchising. We could really use your support. Unfortunately, the banks don't want to support us as small business entrepreneurs. If you're an entrepreneur, you probably know the same problems that we're facing. And what you guys were saying, really about dress. It's
dress for success.
Dress.
Can't say it enough.
You can't.
Can't say it enough.
You know, my mother told me years ago that you dress for the job you want, not for the job you have. And from a very little girl, that's what I learned. And you know, as a divorce attorney in one of the top five firms in New Jersey, certainly image is important. And if you don't dress the part, I think that you might leave some opportunities on the table.
You do.
Right? When
you're certainly. And I think, you know, who do you want to represent you? Where do you want your clothes to come from? Couture, yes, we love couture, but there's also other places that you can go and still look like a great executive.
Well, so, all right, so let's play on this. So since we're at this point, let's get a full introduction of you, what
As
you
I
do,
sip
and,
my
why
wine.
You, and why you the, started, became the, a divorce attorney.
The exhausted divorce attorney. So, yes, so I am a divorce attorney with the law firm of Bud Larner in Short Hills. As I mentioned earlier, we are one of the top five firms in New Jersey.
I was going to say, what an awesome
It's an incredible an
awesome firm.
Firm. We are coming shortly on our 100-year anniversary. So we have, a lot of talent that's been there for a very long time. Nobody's 100 years old, but listen, it spreads, right? We really pride ourselves on being the brightest and the best because we take on very complicated issues and fight for the underdog if we need to. And we're a full service law firm, so it's not just divorce. But I think that what I enjoy the most about working at a firm like Bud Larner is that we will explore every facet of your case to make sure that you end up on the right side of where you need to be. And, you know, when I got here today, we talked about the fact that you yourself are, going through a life change. And with that life change comes so many other things, which is why Susan and I started working together. When you're getting divorced, you might as well just rip up the paper and say, blank sheet, what am I doing now? Mm-hmm. And with that comes, I need to dress myself. I need an executive coach. I need a mover. I need a doctor. I need a financial planner. So what I love about this opportunity and all these types of collaboration is that my clients get the best
Right.
of everything when they come to me for, I have to start my life anew.
And I don't think most people realize, so look, there's a lot of lawyers out there that are great lawyers, but so many people get burdened and they forget the small details. And that's what I appreciate about what you were telling me when you were telling me about your company a while ago. It's even in my business and your business, right?
Well,
it's attention to detail. And when you're starting a new life, you don't know. You think you know where to start, but
it's critical. And before Susan chimes in, and I know that she has valuable information to add here, the way that I practice is, and really my motto, my platform is, a smart woman knows how to protect her ass sets. So you have the ass, right? The ass has to look good. You'll make it look good. But if you don't have the complete picture of your finances, of your life, of your loans, of your debts, if you don't have that, then I don't care how I dress you, you're not going to be a success.
No.
So how I succeed is to collaborate with all sorts of extremely vetted, well-known professionals such as yourselves, introduce them to my clients so my clients get a team.
Right.
And as they're turning that page, mascara running, what am I going to do now? Fast forward 24, 48, 72 hours, they feel empowered.
Right.
And I bring people like Susan Asher into my circle, because she provides yet another service. You come into the circle, provide yet another service. Without that, divorce is going to be brutal. We make it palatable.
And that's, look, I mean, you know, I've gone through it, and it's emotional. But
it's emotional.
You were going to say something before I get into the emotional part.
Well, I want to say I should probably introduce myself.
You did. You have to.
I have to,
The
yes.
world knows this woman as Lady Asher.
Is that who you are?
Well, yes.
I read about that.
It's true.
We met, Caroline and I had the good fortune to meet when we were on a trip with Leading Women Entrepreneurs, and we were in Ireland, and I got there a day or two early before everybody else because, if you don't know this, I'm an avid golfer. When I told somebody that I played 100 rounds of golf last year, they said, how the heck do you do it? Well, you know, there's lots of hours in the day. They're not just 9 to 5. So,
right.
And that's another thing people have to realize. There's and you know, we're always collaborating, working, networking, doing what we have to do. But anyway, we met there, and that was the beginning of our collaboration and our friendship and all the things that we've been able to do for people. So, but what I am really passionate about is everybody can continue always to go to that next level. Okay?
Yes.
But we also have to understand, and that includes me, and we're even talking now the investment that we're going to make in our show that will be coming up. We have to invest in ourselves, particularly as entrepreneurs, or even in a corporation. You have to invest in yourself. Not every company is going to train you and give you the tools that you need for the future. So that's
right.
Number one, invest in yourself. Number two, your network. I am a huge fan of people meeting up. And so I have two different things that I do. One is Course Connections on the golf course, teaches people who don't even know anything about the game to play.
Right.
And network beyond that, because golfers make more money. Golfing executives make more money than most people because
right.
they're making those big, big networking collaborations.
Well, would you say that at your events, whether it's culinary or course, that being
dressed,
appropriately
exactly.
dressed is key?
Exactly. And
key.
The other thing I want to say, so those are the things that people have to understand. You have to continue to take care of your image, which
yes.
is what you do. You have to take care of yourself, and you've got to really be looking at what, not just networking when you're looking for a job or you're in transition. How do you build that network? And it's funny because there's a Broadway show out now that I just saw the other day called 6 Degrees of Separation. And we probably should all, I have seen it in another time, but we should probably have everybody go and see that because it's really, really true. If you and I were to sit here for, you know, 5 minutes and talk only about that.
We know the
it would be
people.
Amazing how many people we would
yeah.
have in common.
Oh, it's, and look, I mean, what this crew here does, right, is very crucial to
people's
someone getting
success.
Divorced, someone starting a new job. I think people forget that they don't think they need an executive coach.
They
think I've been in the business for 20 years. What do I need an executive coach for?
Well, I want to just say one thing, and that goes back to how you dress, too. What I am finding, particularly now it's going down to Generation X, they're the next tier, but baby boomers in particular, we have to stay relevant. In one of the books that I wrote, I have a chapter on staying relevant.
So you have a book?
I have two books.
So what is your book?
My first book is Dude. Seriously, Dude. It's not all about you. And that is all about modern manners or lack thereof. It's my rant on people not knowing how to behave in society anymore because of these things.
I know.
And these things. And the second book is, along with Carolina's Assets, is Dude, Seriously, Get Your Asking Gear. So that is a book on modern leadership. They're both about 100 pages long. They're not in the fashion of Sheryl Sandberg or, you know, Jim Collins, where you have to read 600 pages. It's a very short book, but talking about staying relevant. What we wore even 10 years ago, yeah, some of those pieces you can wear again.
Right.
But maybe, you know this, the lapel gets a little narrower, wider. The color changes a little bit. So what do you do to keep that? I don't know how old this jacket is, probably brand new because you're in the business, but let's say this is 10 years old. All of a sudden you put a pop of color with it. It's a whole
new look.
Right.
And you're relevant and you look, you know, when I send people on interviews and they're in their 50s, I mean, do you want to be... You want to be relevant.
You want to be fresh.
You want to be fresh. Yeah. Fresh, okay?
Because the competition is fierce.
It's fierce. And I think what Susan's books bring out is that you need to look great.
Right.
That's, you know, there's no two ways about that.
Right.
But if you don't have your gift of gab, if you don't have your resume put together, if you don't have the topics covered, right, if you don't have your financial and your wherewithal about you and your portfolio in order, then that 30 seconds of when you walk in and they're like, wow, she looks great, is going to be undermined by your lack of presentation thereafter.
You've got to be prepared.
So your world of image and beauty and my world of protecting your assets and Susan coaching people to bring it all together, that's the secret sauce.
No, it is. And if you guys have any questions, just put your comments in. They're here all night with me. So don't hesitate to... Venus, I know. I didn't realize the sound was off.
Oh,
it's back on.
Rachel Anevsky is watching us.
Oh, hey, hi, Rachel.
And congratulations on your award.
Yes, and your anniversary. Council. And she had a four-year anniversary today for starting her own business. That's another one that we need to have on the show.
Kudos.
She's another
woman
entrepreneur.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shout out to Rachel Anevsky.
So we were talking before about the GoFundMe campaign, and I was telling Susan, and I'm not sure if anybody caught it because, like an idiot, it was my first show by myself. Kudos to me. I didn't realize I had the mute button on. But
but this is why failure on you're not a failure, but having a mistake like that is good because you can learn from it.
Exactly.
And now you're never going to do that again.
Never going to do it again. Yep. I'll get my hand slapped. Remember when you used to get your hand slapped?
Yeah, yeah.
But we were talking about our GoFundMe campaign because the Small Business Loan Administration, small business banks are not giving us any money. And we're trying to raise money for our premiere or our attempt to get onto the Shark Tank. So please GoFundMe.com, Buco or Buco Couture. But what we did discuss was when Buco Couture gets to its point, and I think we're going to probably wind up partnering up on something like this. I grew up in foster care. I'm not sure if you guys heard it. Lived on my own, raised on the streets, went through the drug scene and almost died. And I had to make a decision. Do I go on with life or do I just become a part of society that society doesn't want?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So once we're stable, more than stable in our company, we're going to open up a foundation for foster kids and orphans, mm-hmm, and we're going to give them an opportunity. We're going to business plan everything and we're going to help fund their first adventure, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, their first
fabulous
entrepreneurship.
It's incredible opportunity.
So I think it's something that we're going to get into. But I want you to tell us where we can get your book at.
Okay, so actually we're just changing that, and you're going to be able to go to my website, and you're going to be able to click on the book there, and you can get that through PayPal. So
nice.
And simply because, and we love Amazon, it's nothing against Amazon, it's just a whole lot easier to do it through us. We ship it to you, and you can write us an email, you can go on PayPal, but that's the way you're going to get it, on my website. It's just seamless that way.
And what's good is, because of this show, you guys are going to start a show, which I love it.
We've been thinking about this for so long.
But you could talk about the book on the show. The book,
yeah.
I think...
These books, the first book...
People don't like to read. I'm partially dyslexic. I have a hard time reading.
Okay.
So I do a lot of the audio. But some people love to read, and these are books that...
Well, this is an easy read.
It's a very fun
little thing to have in your pocket. Yeah.
It was on my blog this week that... successful people, and I emailed my daughter the article because she is an avid reader. Successful people read one book a week on average. Okay. But what I say when I'm talking to college students and I'm coaching them, I will say to them, okay, let's stop for a minute. You don't read that much, but if you read 10 pages a day, is that a lot?
No.
Okay. 365 days of the year, you will have read 3,650 pages a year.
It's a wonderful commitment to make.
Okay? Yeah. That's a few books. So if you're not the person that can read, and you know, for me, I mean, we're always running around. So I read generally right before I go to sleep at night. Obviously, I can't read 100 pages.
Right.
I'm an early bird, as a lot of executives that I know are. I love to be up at 5 and do so much between 5 and 10 when then everything goes crazy. And then I've already got my ducks in a row. But... that first book, I mean, the chapters there are please, thank you, I'm sorry. Okay? Now, when I say to you in a restaurant, thank you, you pour me coffee, thank you, and you say no problem, my skin crawls.
Yeah.
Really? why would it be a problem? Why would it be a problem? You're waiting on
you
me.
You don't want to do this one in a restaurant.
Why would it be a problem? So that, you know, those.
I'm going out to eat you because I am the fussiest eater you can ever imagine. I make my own sauce, by the way, right?
Your own gravy?
My own gravy. Mm. Well, yes. No, yes. My own sauce.
You called sauce.
My
not
sauce
gravy.
Is for my pasta. My gravy's for my meat. Oh. I know. I'm gonna get
oh,
the
then
head.
You're not real Italian.
I'm gonna get my hand handed to me. But I one of my clients is Nanina's in the Park. The owners
love
of Nanina's
restaurant.
In the Park.
Love yeah. that
they
restaurant.
Just opened up another 2 catering halls. The one is absolutely gorgeous. So he's like, do me a favor, try this sauce. I'm like, all right. Do you know? And now I'm not lazy. I don't make sauce anymore. I buy theirs. It tastes like grandma's.
Just like yours. Like
amazing.
Yours.
Like mine. Like
that's
mine.
A great plug for them, but they're but, in fabulous.
Hey, that could be another product for you. Carmen Bucco sauce.
Bucco sauce.
My brother already has a restaurant. Let him
okay,
do that crap.
Okay. yes,
so
go ahead.
So and you're right. So one thing I want to ask if your book touches on, because you did bring up something. So when I open the door for somebody and they don't say thank you.
But that's it. This is the world we live in. And okay.
I scream.
Here's my rant. Here's my rant.
No matter.
For all of you who want to hear it, it's the demise of the family unit.
Yes.
It simply is. And here's the other problem. You know, when you're bringing up a child, saying no to them is the hardest thing. Much easier to let them run off and grow like weeds and do whatever they want. And this is what our society has become.
Yes.
I listen when I'm driving from client to client in the afternoon. I will listen to Dr. Laura Schlesinger, and I'm like, gee, I'm starting to sound like her. I mean, these people call up and say, well, my son doesn't want to go to work. He doesn't want to have his extra job. And she says to him, well, what time is the job? He goes, well, Saturdays and Sundays from 8 to 12. And she says to the father, and she goes, I'm going to put you on speakerphone. She says, no, you're going to own this. You're the authority. You have the
right.
authority
Take ownership.
Here. Take ownership. And he says, oh, really? I wanted him to hear it from you. No, he's going to hear it from you. And so she says, and so why? What's the problem? He goes, well, he wants to be with his friends on Friday and Saturday nights.
There's got to be boundaries.
There has to be
rules.
You know,
but Susan made a point of, you know, the breakdown of the family unit. I mean, divorce happens in one out of two couples, right?
Right.
So yeah, first-time divorces, second-time divorces, third-time. Believe it or not, third-time divorces. You do.
Sure.
People have this, in my
opinion.
Is it
like married to get divorced?
I think I put my clients in different categories.
No, people don't align their values with
one another. I think that you start a marriage because, you know, it's your family's pushing you to get married.
Right.
And then you turn a certain age and you've hit your career and you're a success, let's say, and you want to start it anew. You're mismatched, and then you have your last marriage, if you will. And those marriages tend to probably last because somebody's going to die. But
or they have no more money.
With that said, because...
So I shouldn't look for money the next time around?
I'm not going to say that. But I think what's...
Just as easy to fall in love with a wealthy woman.
I think to Susan's point, though, is that because we have so much divorce in our society, mm-hmm. that it's so much more important to try to keep the family values, which comes with the manners, with the traditions,
and having
right?
time.
Yes.
And, you know,
blended families... Yeah. Younger wife, all these things come into play, and how easy is it just to shut it out?
Well,
and right? that's you're right, because some of my friends who were getting divorced truly loved their family, but the couple didn't work. So here's what, and I ask a lot of questions. I guess it's through just human nature. So I have a couple clients who were getting divorced, right, and this is something I think that I wanted to get deep into you guys with. There's an emotional problem, right? So the husband and wife became such friends, they forgot to date throughout the course of the marriage, that it broke and fell apart somewhere, and people strayed. So when people stray, you know, you've dealt with a lot of divorces. Are they able to mend that trust
100%.
Barrier back?
You know, I often, and I don't want to promote this because it's not a good calling card to have, but I swear when you call me and you come to consult with me and I get involved in the case, you fall back in love with your spouse. I don't know if I scare people into the fact of what this is going to look like, but I should really be a matchmaker.
But that's a good thing because no, it is a good thing.
Because I think they're missing something, right? They're forgetting.
People need a wake-up call. Right. You know, when you come for consultation with a divorce attorney or you meet with an executive job coach about taking the next plunge in your career, you have a time of reflection. And sometimes that time of reflection makes you realize what you will miss if you let the, you know, if you let the door close,
right,
or what you're not doing, or, you know, what this change will look like. Change is scary, isn't it? Not to say you don't make the change because you're too scared, but sometimes you just need a time out. Mm-hmm. You know, life has become too easy with, I'll just get another job, I'll just get a new husband, I'll just get a new wife.
We used to call it the plastic society.
Just, well, right.
And,
the answer,
and I talk to a lot of older couples and I'm like, you know, what did you do to stay together? I don't get it. Even on the dating scene, I'm on the dating scene, and I'm a believer that everybody's looking for the next best thing. They don't realize, they don't give you an opportunity to show you what you are, right?
Yeah. It's shiny new factor.
Or I talked earlier about investment, right? So you have an investment when you've been with, you see a lot of couples breaking up at that 20, 25 year mark when the kids are gone,
right?
Because of what you just said.
But so you're saying that that 20, 25 year mark can cause a problem.
Yes, well, that's when
I think your mortality comes into play too,
number
right?
Number one, your mortality. Yeah. Number two, if you've grown apart, you're now saying, well, they're in college, we really have nothing else in common, so let's get divorced. But why not look, because the grass is not always greener, okay? But you've invested the years that you dated, the years that you were married, and again, Caroline and I have talked about this. This is not to say that people don't need divorce attorneys.
Right.
But if the marriage is truly dead, I understand it. But if you can look back at your investment in your life, maybe there's something there that you can rekindle, and that's what you're saying.
Well, and two things I'd ask you. What did you mean by mortality?
I think that people, as they go through life, they realize that they're closer to the end than they were, you know, 10, 15 years ago. And people want to be happy. At the essence of who we are,
right,
we want to glow and smile and feel the butterflies and enjoy our lives, right? So when you don't have that and you fall into a routine, you automatically think that, well, if I dump this and start anew, it's going to be
different.
And it may be. And it, right? But people say, well, am I going to do this when, you know, I'm 70 or 80? I just turned 50. I look great. I feel great. I'm gonna start this anew.
And I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, go ahead,
ladies. Michelle, you have a question. I'm sorry, I don't have the phone lines working, but Michelle, just type in your question, and we'll definitely have one of the ladies answer it for you. All right, go ahead.
I want to say, Carolina, while it's fresh in my mind, and we work on this with people and businesses and teams and individuals, and it's the same thing in a marriage. You should marry somebody who has your core values, okay? Whatever they may be. Are they family? Are they getting up early, staying out late? You like to play golf, I like to play golf.
Except that when you get married when you're 27 and all of a sudden you're 47, but do you find that those values change because people evolve?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Not your core values. Not your core values.
So do you think that at 25 you're developed enough to...
Core values today are very similar to what they were when I was 23.
I believe that you should, and even when I was in politics, is always stay true to who you are.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And I've never changed. Now I'm a pain in the ass at times because I'm Italian, I'm stubborn, right? We know Italians are stubborn.
You've evolved. I don't know if the word has changed. We've all evolved.
But also, hopefully, what I realized in my marriage is I was working so hard that I forgot to take time to smell the roses and be a part of a family, right?
I think that
happens now a lot.
I think, you know, and I myself went through a divorce and I was married to, and maybe he's watching, hello, I'm not gonna say his name, but, you know, a very ambitious, you know, aggressive type of an individual, attorney, politician, you know, nothing is ever enough and let me reach for the stars. And I think that when you're, and I'm speaking for my clients, that when you're married to someone that is so focused in their career and you're the spouse, you may lose yourself. So not that my core values ever changed, but I think that post my divorce and me going to law school and becoming an attorney and fast forward, I think that I tapped into dormant traits that I didn't need when I was married to somebody who was a rock star. You know what I mean? So I think
that's evolution too,
yes.
But you had a different case, which I'm not going to go into, but because hey, there are reasons to get divorced. But what I'm saying is that for many, many people, they think the grass is greener. They hang from the chandeliers for the first year of being together, and then all of a sudden the bills come in, somebody gets sick, somebody dies, and guess what? That's part of life. And if you share your values, you're going to work on that to get through that together.
So let me take this a step further. So we know that with divorce becomes, there's a lot of emotion that gets involved in it. There's a lot of anger, right?
Absolute betrayal.
So what I've learned and doing my research is there's even in a relationship, there's sections, right? There's anger, forgiveness.
Go through the stages.
What are the stages that, and I think it happens to everybody.
It does.
I don't believe in therapists. I really don't. I've been to them even when I was a kid. And what I've learned on the streets and through my clients has been more valuable than a therapist. So, and I'm not saying that there's a purpose for them.
Sure.
I'm a believer. I don't believe in therapists. But what we're hearing now is technically you don't need a therapist. You need to be your own therapist and find out what the problems
were. And you need the right team around
in the relationships.
I think that
the
two threads that I see is anger and then fear. So first clients come in and they're like, how could this have happened? You know, how could she have done this? How could he have done this? You're angry because your life is, you know, the bricks on the wall, it's being ripped apart, right? And then when it tumbles and it crumbles, now you're afraid because it's the unknown.
Right.
So at both stages of anger and fear, it's important to bring in the right support system to help build up. Nobody could do this alone.
So,
nobody could go through
so
a change
alone. If I'm getting divorced ever again.
We hope not.
First we need the prenup, then we need the...
when we talk about a team, and for those of you who are going through a divorce, I believe in these two ladies, and I've had many conversations with them before they even came on the show. When you talk about a team, tell me about when you're in that position, what that team is to make the emotional part of it and the fear, the anger you can't do anything about.
Excuse me, that's another chapter in my second book, Meet Fear, Your New Best Friend.
Yeah.
Because fear does one of two things. It either propels you forward or it holds you back.
Well, let me tell you something.
And we obviously want it to propel us, right?
So that's what address it. Yeah. We don't address
Two-minute story, and I don't care. So many people know my life. I went through the party scene. I did a bunch of... I partied hard one night. When I closed my eyes, I saw the gates of heaven. And my friends found me 2 days later sitting on a porch step.
2 days, 48
That was
hours.
The day I turned around, and I didn't even know what happened. That was the day I turned around, and rightfully so, what you're saying, I fear nothing anymore. And
you
I don't
hit rock bottom.
Right. So how do you overcome that fear that you're talking about? And not fear
you need
the inevitable.
You need people.
So for my clients, I think fear comes from not understanding. So I'm afraid I will not have enough money to make it
future,
on my own.
The future.
And that comes from not understanding your portfolio, right?
Right.
I'm afraid I'm going to lose my house. Well, that's not understanding if you have a mortgage or a home equity loan or what your percentage rate is. You know, it's from not... So what I do is in whatever your level of understanding is, I explain to you everything you need to understand, whether I have a forensic accountant with me or I have a social or whatever, whoever it needs to be, to give you all the cards you need to make the decisions for yourself. So now that fear's gone, now the sky's the limit. Because when, just to your point, when you're not afraid, you'll do anything.
Right.
But if you're afraid, you'll do nothing.
And you'll stay...
You'll perpetuate. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy if you're afraid.
But I think if you're afraid, I mean, I've been fearful of things and they have propelled me forward.
Well, because you push yourself. And I'm the same person as Susan is in that front. When I'm afraid, I know that that's an opportunity to cross to the other side. Because if something makes you uncomfortable, it means you have to address it, and either over, under, or around, you got to get past it. People that say, I'm afraid and I'm now stagnant, are the ones that don't experience growth. And if you don't experience growth, you're bound to repeat your mistakes.
I want to answer that because Dr. Laura answered a question like that today.
So we're going to... Michelle gave us a question Yeah, I don't have my glasses. You have your
why
glasses.
Why would a man why would a man secretly stay in a relationship with his ex-wife? No kids. Wife cheated on him for so many years after while in another relationship. Not sexually, but keeping the connection seems off color. Well, see, I don't think he's a man. Michelle, I don't think he's a man. I think he's a man child. Because why is he doing that? Because he's a wimp.
So this is a man that divorced his wife and he's keeping in touch with the ex-wife
yes.
while he's in a new relationship. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll speak to the other side of that. And because I obviously,
have children and they're co-parenting, that's one thing. But that doesn't sound like
it. But even if there's no children, I think that, and being divorced and being a divorce attorney, I think that unless you have closure on your relationship, okay?
No, they obviously
if you're the
don't.
One that's caught off guard and your marriage falls apart and you didn't see it coming, there's a whole lot of work to do to close that chapter. So
yeah.
You keep the lines of communication going because you need to know what happened. So there's that. Then there's also you actually like the person and you lost the marriage and you lost the love and you lost the sexual relationship maybe, but this was your friend for 27 and a half years, let's say.
Right.
It's hard to just throw that away. So I think that we treat each situation
separately. Yeah.
And you have to, in her situation, I would say, speak to this person. Why are you speaking to Mary Jo? Why are you still involved?
Right, because there may be a reason behind it.
What's the need that she's fulfilling while you're in a new relationship?
But you know what? And he's probably doing it secretly because he doesn't want to hurt her.
Hurt her feelings. It's very
complicated. Right. So, and I can understand that from a guy's point of view because women are emotional. Guys are...
reactionary?
Yeah.
No.
What do you think they are?
I don't think guys have emotion, but I don't think guys are.
They're very linear. I mean, and they're very everything's in a box. So they usually put it on a shelf. So he's probably thinking, well, I can do that. I can do that over here on the side, and nobody will.
That's true.
Maybe listen. You got to sometimes you got to just call it what it is. You know, if the man did not want the relationship to end, and although there was a divorce, and he's not done with the relationship. Maybe this is an opportunity to try to rekindle that relationship. You don't know,
but he's in a relationship with another woman.
But I mean...
I don't think... I personally don't think you ever lose the feelings for somebody, right? Because 5 years down the road, I mean, you may walk in front of your ex and then all of a sudden be like, see the movie with Vince Vaughn?
The Breakup?
The Breakup. Right?
So 20 times. I love that.
But so many of those movies.
Wait, do you look like Vince Vaughn?
A little
He's
bit.
He's a lot taller.
Yeah.
I dye my hair.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm
giving away that's why.
I think we all dye our hair. We're just going to get that out there right now.
Get a little help from our hairdresser.
If I don't, I look like the dude from The Sopranos with the gray patch.
Oh, Paulie.
Paulie.
I love Paulie.
I like Paulie too.
How you doing? And you met Tony Soprano. How you doing?
Oh, yeah.
My uncle made the clothes for him.
Is that right?
Yeah, my uncle made the clothes for him and a couple other guys on The Sopranos.
I was, what's that restaurant in Cedar Grove?
Was it in Verona?
No.
Mangia Cuesta?
No. In Cedar Grove. Oh, I can't think of it right now. It's a steakhouse on Route 23.
And
he was there. It was so funny. You know, I was using the power to bring him into that restaurant, which he was a partner in. And I was with friends, and I said, boy, I hope he shows up tonight. And I said to the waiter, does he come here? And he goes, rarely, but actually he'll be here tonight. It's his wife's birthday. This was the end of January, the year that
his
he
died. His wife's show or his show, or his real wife?
No, his real
not Carmella.
Wife. Beautiful Asian woman. And the whole family was there. Anyway, he walked by the table to go to the back room where they were having the event. And he walked by with those piercing blue eyes. And I looked at him and I couldn't help myself. I go, how you doing? And he said to me, I'm doing good. How you doing? And he was really a very down-to-earth guy. That was the end of January, and I was at a dinner party, mm-hmm. and my daughter called me from Denver and said, Ma, James Gandolfini just died.
Yeah.
And it was so weird because I had met him, and he was a great guy.
You know, and I have to give a plug at this point. I'm actually working with on a project with Tom Giacomoro, who is the real Tony Soprano. And because this hit the circuit today in People Magazine and elsewhere, I'm able to talk about this. But we're working on a book called The King of Con. And Tom Giacomoro is going to be taking the talking circuit, talking about his life as the real Tony Soprano and being the King of Con.
We'd love to have him.
So, and Tom will be watching this tomorrow, probably on YouTube. But you've never met a more dynamic personality. Not as big as Tony Soprano, but keep your pants on. Yeah. Keep your pants on. King of Con.
So, I can't believe it's actually 8:45. I told you.
Oh, it goes time flies
quick. When you're having fun.
I'm telling you.
Yeah.
We're actually going to skip the week in review because I think there's a lot more to discuss here. So forgive us. We're going to skip the week in review. And we're gonna skip the commercials. I know you people don't like commercials.
Wow.
We're gonna skip the commercials because we only have 15 minutes.
Okay.
You know, so why don't we talk a little bit about, because this is actually what we prepped for before we went to, you know, all these other topics, the importance of looking like $1 million, mm-hmm. but really not having what makes that on the inside.
Now,
right?
let me say, and my grandmother used to say, when you have manners, you can go anywhere. And this is what I want your audience to know, okay? Now, so what we want you to have is we want you to have both. We want you to be dressed appropriately.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And we want you to also dress like the person in those clothes. I saw Prince Charles somebody did a biography on him. He still, every morning, we don't have this, but has a valet dressing him. I mean, obviously he's you know, the Prince right. of England, but my grandmother, even with table manners, used to tell me, German lady, and Germans loved the Brits because they were slightly higher authority. She used to say to me, Susie, you must always eat as if you were with the Queen of England.
Always, always.
And you know, when I would slump over, she'd be like, nope. But I would say, no one's here. No, you must always eat that way. And it becomes a way
of
being, and it's the same way with dress.
Yeah.
You know, it's what we have to do.
I think what we lack as a society these days is that people are so caught up in image, you know, the hair, the eyelashes, the clothes, the shoes, the bags. So, yeah, they got that down, right?
Right.
But then when you open your mouth or when you try to have a conversation.
Or how about your heart? You know, how about your heart?
There's nothing to add. It's not enough, yeah. right? It's not enough for you to dress someone. You need to work on the inside. Mm-hmm. If you want the long-lasting relationship, a good job, to be a club member somewhere, to have the conversation.
I won't
mention any names, but.
Oh, please do.
I hope you're watching. I feel name drop.
And it, basically, divorce is 60%. Let's be real, right? And I deal with a lot of guys who their wives have cheated on them. And a lot of my clients have shopped other places. A lot of my newer clients have shopped other places. And one client in particular used to spend $4,000 on a suit. And I said, why are you doing that? Blah, blah, blah. He was referred to me. I sat down. I had a conversation with him. And for some reason, I have a likable personality. They tell me everything.
We feel the same
I'm
way.
I'm like, and the Italian, right? I'm like a brick wall. Not that this is a real brick wall, but.
You could have
once. once I took him under my wing, dress-wise, his fear of not being good enough for women took such a turn. He's dating girls half his age now, and he's like, I walk more confident, I feel more confident, the clothes are less expensive, and I get better service.
Well, I think it's like the whole makeover story, right? So if you make somebody over, and you could do that, you can make people over, you can make men right. over and make them look gorgeous, but it's only going to take them so far if they don't do the other work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So right. you're 100% right.
You need the coaches.
We don't want an empty suit is what we're saying.
Right, right,
and
right.
by the way, may I say this to your audience? I mean, what is this business of dating someone half your age? Why is this attractive when you have nothing generationally in common with the other person?
Well, you would know, right?
Would I date a man half my age?
You would. No?
Yes, you would. Hell yeah, you would.
What would I have
you're like, you're like, eye candy, take me to bed tomorrow.
Listen, we were in France, not the last summer, the summer before that.
Yeah.
I had a strapper in, keeper down, this one.
We had a good time.
So if you a 29-year-old guy comes up to you and says, I want you, what are you going to do?
No, listen, I actually had a guy.
You're not going to say
guy
no.
once who was 19 years, I was just telling a friend this the other night, 19 years younger than me, and he was a Match.com date, and he lied about his age. So he was only 10 years younger, which is fine, since we outlive you by 8 years. I was okay with that. So we go on this date, and I start doing the math where he went to school, and I'm like, wait a second, Barry, you're 39 or whatever he was
I'm
at
sorry,
the time.
But this is a great question.
Oh, let's do it, yeah.
Because Michelle loves to ask questions. I love you, Michelle. I miss you, actually.
Because they're,
why are men intimidated? Now, I'm going to tell you, as a man, I am not intimidated by a strong woman. I love a strong woman. I'm going to tell you why. Mm-hmm. You got to be able to put up with my sarcasm and my ball busting. But not only that, but you have to be an independent woman to, God forbid, we're in a relationship, we're married, and you don't have a job. Like you said, when you get divorced, the fear is they don't have something outside. Right. To me, a strong woman is on par, and I think you have to be a strong-willed man
to be
able to handle
okay,
that.
Let me say this, and this is and those of you who are mothers of young men, here is where the problem starts. You are not raising men. You are raising man children. You are doing everything for them so that when they go out into these snowflakes, go out into the real world where mommy has done everything, you know, they don't want a strong, because they need a woman like mommy who's going to do everything for them.
Right.
You, with everything that you've done and overcome in your life, you're right, you're a strong man. And personally, and I think you would agree with this, we like men that want to hunt us down. We don't want to hunt them down, but our society, it's turned the other way.
But why do they want the challenge? What's the big deal about the challenge? It
gets tiring. Why do women not want the challenge?
Why do they want the challenge?
Who wants the challenge?
The women. They want you to chase and chase and chase. And
because we want a man. It's not chasing. It's not chasing.
But you don't have to be a man to chase.
No. There's, yes. Okay.
This is actually, by the way, this is actually the gentleman's club portion.
Whether you
want to
be, because there are women that are men, there are men in the relationship, and the man is okay with that. But it depends on who you are.
Okay. So I'm going to give you this.
Yeah.
Right? I told a friend of mine, the reason why your marriage isn't working is because you put your wife on the pedestal all those years and never took her down from the pedestal, and she needed a man, right? She was looking for a man to say, I don't need to be on that pedestal. Treat me like a woman, basically.
Or a person.
I think there needs to be chemistry and common ground, right? There's no easy answer to this. I think different people want different things.
But you have to know who you are in a relationship. If you're the strong woman, yeah, and they're the woman that goes to work every day and the guy stays home with the kids, well, then he does have a little bit more of a masculine side. But when you are women like us, I don't think, you know, we have to be strong all day long in what we're doing, coaching, helping people through divorce. I know at 5 o'clock when I leave the office, I want to be the woman.
She wants to be manhandled, not be with a pansy.
Yeah, I want to be.
Just putting it out there.
No, and you know what? I want to be the girl. You are absolutely right.
Yeah.
Women. I don't give a shit what women say. Excuse my French, but you know what? 50 Shades of Grey was watched by millions of women.
This is turning into an X-rated show.
No, and you know what? Women do want that, but they won't fess up and own up to that.
Well, for Michelle that asked the question about why men are intimidated by strong women. She's not talking to the right men. The right men, right? They want a strong woman. They do.
Absolutely.
It's the banter, the conversation, yeah. You know, they make
you're
it.
You're on the same level.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. She needs to step up her game.
No, but here's what I'm saying. These men are going away, and a lot of it is because the women that are on the dating scene, they call up. They ask men out. They do, but that's what they want to do.
It would be nice if somebody asked me out on a date. Why do I always have to ask?
It depends on what you, the type of woman you want. Okay, I don't particularly care to ask a man out on a date. It's not even talking about.
You wouldn't say to a guy, you know what? Let me buy you a drink.
No, because I'm strong enough the way it is. I don't want to be that. I have to be that all day long, and yes.
But what if the guy likes you and he's intimidated to come up to you?
Which happens every day.
Okay, I'm not going to say that would never happen, but generally speaking, I am not going to go
on a match.com. I was intimidated to come up to her when I met her in Ireland in the castle with her clubs and a driver. I'm like, can I talk to this woman? Imagine the poor man.
It's ridiculous.
Right.
Listen, us guys
are afraid. Not that we're afraid of rejection, because if you say no, you say no. It's a numbers game.
I get rejected.
Right, you get divorced. You're back on the dating scene. It's a numbers game.
But the odds are that you'll be with somebody in a very short time because people recycle. I mean, this is why I'm divorcing people the second and third time. People remarry and get divorced, and I see this all the time. People are right back out there, and sometimes people start relationships long before the divorce is over.
Well, that's not
right?
healthy either.
But they
yeah,
do.
That's not healthy.
Because people want to be with other people. So doing that in a healthy way is at the core of what we're talking about.
Right.
But there's no shortage of people out there to be with. It's just getting yourself into the right crowd.
Exactly.
So this woman, if she's saying that, you know, she's not meeting the right people, change your environment. Right? Where are you?
Well, and that's what I had, and that's one of the things I had to do when I went through my issues. You're right. I changed my environment and said, "What do I want to do? What do I want in my life? And who do I want in my life?"
Right.
And
you're not
going
to go to a bowling alley if you want to meet, I don't know, the top plastic surgeon that works in L.A.
Why? You might be a bowler.
Well, then you got to go to the bowling alley in California. But I mean, like, you need to put yourself in the right place,
well, that's
right?
That's true, too.
If
that's
you want to meet a golfer, yeah. I guess is a better example, you're not going to hang out at the bowling alley. You're going to go hang out at the golf course, like
I'm
you
a
like
bowler,
to say.
Though, too.
But, you know,
you're not listening to me. You don't believe me, right?
I do believe you. Because she'll go to, you know, the supermarket and meet a top plastic surgeon.
So,
but you have to put yourself in the right space,
yeah.
don't you think?
Yeah.
We don't
yeah.
have much more time,
yes.
but I want to reiterate because I really enjoyed this show, and I can't believe it's 8:56 already.
Wow.
And I told you it goes by.
No commercials,
quick.
No nothing.
We didn't have time for anything. Tell me about your position, and when you say teen, tell me what
guys
who are getting a divorce, the team that you want to put together, so guys or women getting divorced, the team that you want to put together, so when they get through that anger, you help them get through the fear, and you take them to the happy stage.
So I think that every single person that comes in to see me, the first thing is, let's deal with the finances. So do you need to sell your house? Do you need a real estate person, a finance person, a broker? If there's mental health issues, do we need to connect you with a social worker, therapist, psychiatrist, etc.? If you need executive coaching, spiritual coaching, life coaching, who's that person?
Right.
If you need to relocate, who's the person that's going to help you relocate? If you need to find a job, how are you building your resume? So essentially, in an interview, in a consultation, as we call it in the law world, it's like a questionnaire. I hear what you're saying to me. I hear what your life is going to now be undone, right? What are we undoing? And where do I put in the right people to support you? It's almost like your anchor while you're now going through divorce. I'll handle the divorce,
right. But
I want you to have a team of people to handle I'm not going to come to your house and do an inventory and pack your stuff.
Right.
Who do you need to do that? Right? If you're going through body image issues, you know, you mentioned the person helps you lose weight. Do you need that person? Do you need a plastic surgeon? Do you need a weight loss specialist? What do you need so that when you and I meet and we're talking about your divorce, that you're paying attention to me and not thinking about the fact that, you know, you're in foreclosure, you need a bankruptcy attorney. We need to assemble the team that's specific to the person's needs, and that's what
and
I
you'll,
do.
And you'll help them put that team together.
Day
I think
one.
That's I think
Day
that's
one.
Important.
Day one.
You know, and
it makes
and like
my
you said,
job easier and it makes you feel better.
Well, and not only that, but it takes the fear. It relaxes the fear because, again, some people may need to get divorced to get divorced.
You know, and I will tell you this. When I was going through my own divorce, I felt completely isolated because I thought that my ex-husband was going to have the team. My divorce attorney for me at the time, and which is why I became attorney, said to me, "You're going to have an entourage." Within 7 days, I had an entourage. So when I'm going through the most painful experience of my life,
you have a support system.
I have people on speed dial. And these are people that want my business down the road. So I'm not paying them. They want to sell my house, or they want to manage my portfolio, or they want to help me get a job. So these people have a vested interest in helping me. And what you get when you come to me is I have vetted professionals. You may never meet a Susan Asher. You come to me, you get a Susan Asher. You know,
well, and you know what? And again, based on my business, when we've talked and we've had plenty of talks, attention to detail to me is very important, and making sure that I take care of that client in the manner that they need to be taken care of and what their needs are. Forget about the money. The money means nothing without that client feeling comfortable and feeling you and knowing that you're in the best interest. When it comes to the divorce is over, or they're going through a divorce, Susan, tell me about how they take them from the unknown to the known.
To the known, yes. So, and it depends. And it's not just career coaching, but it's, you know, we don't live in silos, right? So, you know, that word holistic is way overused, but I work with the whole person. If you're in career transition and that's the main reason you're coming to me, we also have to look at, what are you doing to alleviate the stress in your life? What are you doing to make yourself a more whole person? What are you doing with your image? not just clothing, that's important, but right. your image when you go back out into the world to find a job, to find another mate, you know, and how do you build that network so that anything happens to you in the future, you have your own network in addition to yours that you can draw upon, really helping that person re-enter a whole new world because they don't have somebody by their side to do it, and they have me to help them with that. And really, again, it goes back to anything that people are doing in terms of what we're talking about, the three of us, clothing, divorce, coaching. You have to invest in yourself, and you have to know what you don't know.
That's the most important thing. What I tell like a lot of my clients or my newer clients or guys that I'm trying to make understand. Like I told one guy today, he's like, "Oh, I get my clothes made." I said, "Once you deal with me, you don't ever deal with anybody else." The way you dress is your frontline marketing. Mm-hmm. If I go into a bar and throw on a sweatshirt, you know what? I'll probably pick up a girl.
Communication is in the first 9 seconds that I look at you, I've already decided who you are, what I think of you, and whether I want to know you
but
or not.
But here's the problem.
It's true.
Women
it's
true. Get imitated. Intimidated. Like she was talking about guys getting intimidated. Women, like some girl told me, "I can't date you. You dress too good." I'm like, That means she's not your girl.
She's not your girl.
No, but I'm like, but I take offense to that. How do you say that?
Don't take it personally. She's not your person. She's not
you
for
want
you.
Somebody to say, you know what, that's a great sweater jacket combination. Yeah. The guy knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, we could go on and on and on this evening.
Okay, we'll see you tomorrow night, same time.
Yeah, right? I hope you guys had an awesome, awesome time. I had a great time. I'm hopefully going to invite you guys back.
Oh, love it. We'd love to be back.
But we're going to, you're looking to do your own show, which we're very excited about.
Yes.
It's a great thing.
It's not where you've been, it's where you're going.
It's where you're going.
I cut myself trying to open up the wine bottle for you guys. So once again, remember, we are here to make America dress great again. God bless, and we'll see you next Tuesday. Next Tuesday, I was telling you, and I want to introduce you guys to her.
Yes.
Karen is coming on, who is a weight coach.
A weight coach.
So important.
But I'm going to have to break her into the men's side because she focuses on women. So we want to break her into the men's
image,
side. Because
right?
we want body image, too.
Yeah. 100%.
I want the man boobs.
You want to look like these guys on your wall here with these suits.
Absolutely. So again, once again, God bless. Good evening. Thank you again for joining in. Please don't remember to share and like the Man of Style. We're trying to move everybody over there, and we will see you next Tuesday.
Oh, we should hold on.
What?
Our contact information.
Oh, yes. Let's do that again.
Carolina.
Yes.
So Carolina Denhard, budlarner.com and carolinadenhardesquire.com. You could find me on both websites.
And you can find me at susanasher.com. And you can email me at susan@susanasher.com.
Do you have a phone number?
Absolutely. So 973-315-4524 is my direct office line.
And I am 973-919-8180, directly to me. I'd love to hear from you.
So, and again, and I'll throw my two cents in. I've had conversations with these young ladies for weeks before we've actually even had the show. If you are in the process of a divorce and you're feeling that sense of fear and anger, please, I'm telling you, she is the sweetest person. We had a blast on the trip to Washington, D.C. Call Caroline. When Caroline's going to and needs to work as a team to get you to that next level, and I'm definitely going to make an attempt to read your book. How do we get your book again?
Okay, so you'll go right to my website, and you'll click on the icon for the book, and it will be shipped to you, and you'll pay for it.
Worth the read.
Yep.
Absolutely.
And I promise this is the last time I'll say this evening. When you dress great, you feel great. God bless, and have a beautiful evening.
Good night.
Good night.
The Man of Style is produced and engineered by the New Jersey Podcast Guys and Michelle Bell.